10 reasons to colonize the moon. Number 10, close for comfort. We've all heard a great deal about people wanting to put a colony on Mars and the virtues of such an idea. The problem is that Mars is really far. It would take about 270 days to get there. The moon, on the other hand, is only 3 days away. By the time we're ready to go into space on a regular basis, spaceship transportation should be redundantly overlapping and ready to go at a moment's notice. It would most likely be in a continuous loop, perhaps with daily arrivals and departures, like a modern airline. Even better, communication to experts is about 2 seconds away by radio or video. Mars, on the other hand, could be between 4 and 20 minutes away by radio, and up to 2.5 weeks during the solar conjunction, when Mars and Earth are on opposite sides of the sun and can't communicate at all. Number 9, less time, energy, and radiation. As mentioned, it only takes 3 days to get to the moon now. A one-way trip to Mars, on the other hand, will take between 5 and 10 months, depending on how much fuel you are willing to spend and the size of your payload. With current technology, it would probably be 270 days getting there, 90 days on the surface waiting for a return launch window, and 270 days to get back. That's a lot of time, 630 days, spent absorbing high levels of hard radiation. While you could protect yourself from radiation on Mars while indoors or underground, any time spent on the surface would be bad. Since Mars lacks Earth's magnetosphere, the moon trip is only 6 days outside of Earth's protective magnetic shield. Plus, any radiation from spending time on the surface. Until we develop better protective technology, the moon is far safer for our early explorations and investigations into how to survive. Number 8, has what we need. Aluminum, titanium, oxygen, silica are all readily available on the moon. Even denser metals like copper and iron too. There are even radioactive substances if we want to invest the effort to collect them. Essentially, the moon can provide almost everything we can obtain on Earth, because it is made from the same material from which the Earth was formed. The difference is that in order to use it, we don't have to haul it up out of a 200-mile deep hole in the form of Earth's gravity field. If you were moving from one side of the country to the other, would you bring cement and bricks with you, or obtain them locally when you arrived? Number 7, solar or nuclear. On the moon, we have options for power generation. We could use nuclear generators that can run for decades with no moving parts. They are extremely reliable, and we use them on long-duration probes, such as Voyager probes' radioisotope thermoelectric generators, or RTGs. The easiest one is solar, providing 1,400 watts per square meter of solar panels. That's 40% more than we obtain on Earth, because the moon has no atmosphere to attenuate sunlight. Solar power is almost unusable on Mars, since it is only 590 watts M2 at high noon and almost useless at shallow angles. Robotic explorers like Curiosity are limited in where they can explore, because solar energy is so limited on Mars. On the moon, we can place solar collectors at the North and South poles to stay in permanent sunlight. Wires or microwave transmitters could deliver the power to wherever it was needed. Number 6, water, water everywhere. If you haven't been following along, you might not know that there is plenty of water on the moon. There seems to be some well-reasoned notions that there is plenty of subsurface ice too, and likely not confined to permanently shadowed craters at the pole. And water can be easily turned into hydrogen and oxygen by electrolysis, which when put together makes excellent rocket fuel. We'll be able to obtain so much oxygen from water and processing minerals into pure metals that we can afford to waste it as reaction mass for spacecraft thrusters. That shouldn't be a surprise, really, since oxygen is the third most common element in the universe, after hydrogen and helium. Any habitats we build could have all the oxygen they need for atmospheres inside. Once we start building orbiting colonies, they'll have all the cheap oxygen they need, without needing to haul it up from Earth. Number 5, cavemen. One of the most interesting things about the moon is that it was once volcanically active, just like on Earth. When lava flows, it crusts over, but the liquid continues to flow inside until the source stops. When that happens, the last of the lava flows out, leaving a large tube, like a subway tunnel, with a flat floor and huge vaulted roof. Some are hundreds of yards tall and wide, and miles in length. That could fit entire cities inside the vast underground caverns. Not only could you have 30-story buildings inside, if desired, but artificial lighting could stimulate day-night cycles, so people wouldn't be affected by 2-week-long lunar days and nights. Even more importantly, you would be safe from the solar and spatial radiation when living underground. Number 4, astronomical difference. It seems likely that we'll build monorails to connect all the lunar outposts and settlements. All that electric power needs to be used for something, and it would be safer, faster, and most likely scheduled like a train to move around the surface. As a result, it would make Farside, the non-visible to Earth portion of the moon, easily accessible for astronomers and other scientists to conduct experiments insulated from all the radio noise coming from Earth. We'll build the most sensitive radio telescopes to ever exist. We could look at the atmospheres of distant planets to see if they had the telltale gases that revealed life, or even pollution from a technologically advanced culture like our own. It could answer the most important question in the universe: are there other intelligent civilizations out there? Number 3, wealth we'll probably need. We have massive projects on Earth, like the Iter-Tokamak fusion reactor, which should soon produce net positive energy. It's huge, supported by 35 cooperating nations, and is on the verge of success. There are many other projects working on the fusion problem too. Right now we're using tritium and deuterium, two forms of heavy hydrogen with extra neutrons, to power that research. But in the future, we will quite probably use something called helium-3 to do it in a cleaner way without the neutron radiation. There's practically no helium-3 on Earth, but oddly enough, there's plenty on the moon. The sun's wind deposits it directly on the moon's unprotected surface, possibly to a depth of 3 meters. So all we have to do is scrape it up, separate it out, and send it back to Earth. It's important to note that if we were to obtain the equivalent of one space shuttle payload bay full of helium-3, that it could provide all the energy needs for the entire United States for one full year. All the helium-3 on the moon could power our whole planet for millennia. Number 2, longevity, science, sport. With a low gravity environment like the moon's, we could investigate all sorts of things that aren't possible in Earth's gravity. How about metals made into foam with inert gases inside? An aluminum beam with most of the strength of a solid one, but only a fraction of the weight. It could mean buildings that are 2 miles high because of reduced loading. Similarly, an elderly person hindered by Earth's gravity can function easily in the moon's gravity. Physiologists have even suggested that a lunar lifetime could be 130 years due to reduced physical stresses, and the mere concept of the 2-meter hurdles, the 10-meter high jump, and the 5K human-powered flight race could make the Olympics into a brand new experience. Mostly though, scientific outposts, and eventually cities on the moon, are all preparation for future exploration. There, we can practice until we have solid, reliable technologies that we can use to venture out to Mars or the asteroid field for mining operations, knowing they will work most of the time. Number 1, the survival of humanity. Bolides! These exploding atmospheric fireballs, or objects that create impact craters, happen frequently. A lot of our planet is covered in water, with few people or observers around, so plenty of them go unrecorded. The 60-meter, 197-foot Chelyabinsk bolide of 2013 exploded over that city at a height of 23 kilometers, 14 miles, shattering thousands of windows, collapsed weak buildings, blowing garage doors off their mounts, and injuring hundreds of people. This dangerous intruder was completely undetected until the event itself. We're getting better at identifying them, as shown in this chart. A big one making it all the way to the ground could obliterate Paris or Washington. Manhattan Island could be just a memory. The Chelyabinsk event was about 20 to 30 times more powerful than the atomic bomb used at Hiroshima, so just about any city on Earth could vanish in the blink of an eye. That is a pretty good reason to get a lot of humans off of the Earth. Once that happens, humanity is essentially immortal. Until then, the whole planet is vulnerable to a really big rock, but it only takes a small random one to obliterate the place where you live. If we do not prepare for the worst, and get a significant portion of people off of this single planet, we stand a chance of losing everything. Will we wait until it's too late? We know what happened to the last dominant species that didn't get ready in time. Do you think we should colonize the moon first or Mars? Let us know in the comments below, and then check out the next video that you might find interesting.